Hi, this is Simon with IQRF. After watching the IQ mesh tutorial, it should be clear how an IQRF network operates. Now let me explain you how you can collect data from the whole network effectively and how to send asynchronous packets. If you think the IQ mesh protocol through, pulling data from all nodes in a network would be quite a time-consuming process. The reason is that the time grows exponentially based on the number of the nodes you need to read data from. As you can see on the chart, when you pull data in an IQRF network from 10 nodes, it takes 3 seconds. Reading data from 100 nodes takes already 5 minutes, and in the case of 239 nodes, it's almost half an hour. In this time period, the network cannot be used for anything else, so this could dramatically limit real usability of your network. That's the reason why we've developed the patented fast response command. This command basically sends out a broadcast query, and on the way back, the packet collects data from each node in the network. So instead of having, let's say, 100 of communications there and back in the case of reading data from 100 nodes, with the FRC you have just one communication which reads data from all the 100 nodes at once. Apparently, this must be dramatically faster than the standard polling. And it is. The time to collect data with FRC from 10 nodes is 1 second. From 100 nodes, it's only 12 seconds, and from 239 nodes, it's only 29 seconds. Since the packet can transfer just a limited number of bytes, you can send up to 30 user bytes from the coordinator and collect 2 bits from up to 239 nodes or 1 byte from up to 62 nodes. If you need to read, let's say, 2 bytes of temperature from all nodes in your network, you can read the first byte with one FRC and the second byte with another FRC. For your better understanding, here's a visualization of the whole process. There are 3 phases. The first one is a broadcast of your query or command. Let's say, give me 1 byte temperature. Here you can calculate 40 to 50 milliseconds for a hop, depending on how many bytes you send out. To get data from the nodes that are not routers and to have the process more robust, in the second phase, every node sends its data to all neighbors. This takes 40 milliseconds per node. In the third phase, the last router creates a packet and fills it in with all data it has available. In our case, it means data of the nodes number 1, 2, 5, and 6. The last router sends the packet out, the node number 2 adds data of the node number 3 and forwards the packet in its time slot. Number 6 adds data for the node number 4 and transmits the packet as well. In this way, we receive data from all nodes and you can count with time of 50 milliseconds per each router. There are a few predefined fast response commands that you can use right away. The first one collects information if a new node was pre-bonded by one of the nodes in the network during the remote bonding process. The second one gives you information if there are any data available for reading from UART or SPI peripheral on each node. So once you know there are data available on a particular node, you can send the command to read data just from this node. Again, this will be much faster than the standard polling approach. The third predefined FRC is the acknowledge broadcast. This means that when you send this predefined FRC, you get a feedback from each node if the DPA request was performed or not. So for example, when you send an acknowledge broadcast command to switch on all lights, you'll get a feedback which light was and which one wasn't successfully switched on. This helps you to have your broadcast commands fully under control. The last predefined FRC reads 1 byte temperature from all nodes. With a custom DPA handler, you can create your own fast response commands as well, so it's just up to you what kind of acknowledge broadcast command you want to send or what kind of data you want to read. Now let's say our blue nodes are lights and you want to control them not only with an acknowledge broadcast from your central unit, but locally from a switcher as well. So how can you do it using the IQRF? You will use so-called subnetworks. In order to avoid packet collisions, the main network is running on one channel and the subnetwork on a different one. You can set this up very easily in the TR configuration right here. The sub-coordinator is then listening on both of the channels. A module in your switcher is sleeping to save power, and when you push a button, the module wakes up and sends out the command to the sub-coordinator. The light is switched on an instance and the coordinator of the main network sends out the FRC periodically to check status of each light. So this is the way how you can control your device locally using subnetworks and asynchronous commands. Send broadcast commands with a feedback if the command was performed or not using an acknowledged broadcast, or to read data and statuses from all nodes in the network effectively with the FRC. These tools and features make the IQRF an excellent solution not only for centrally controlled applications such as street lighting or wireless sensor networks, but for more complex installations such as indoor lighting or home automation as well. So, your products could be wireless. With the IQRF, it's even simple. This video is just a small piece of a complete IQRF video tutorial set. To get a full picture and understanding of the IQRF technology, please watch previous and following IQRF tutorials.